Random House Audio presents Who Let the Dogs In? Incredible Political Animals I Have Known by Molly Ivins. Read for you by the author.
The editor of this book, Jonathan Karp, an alarmingly bright young man who appears to be about 14, says he considers this my career retrospective. Jonathan, I explain, that makes me feel slightly dead. So here I sit with a smart kid's selection of my best work, trying to figure out if it means anything. Do we have a theme here? Are there underlying meanings, refrains? Have I done anything for 40 years except laugh at the perfectly improbable nincompoops who get themselves elected to public office? I guess the most amazing refrain is that I still love politics, and still think it matters to every American in more ways than most of them ever guess. And I still think it's funny. And I consider that especially moving testimony, given that I also think American politics is in a state of open corruption and intellectual rot. I have been optimistic to the point of idiocy my whole life, a congenital defect. I assumed that as I grew older, I would become an unnaturally cheerful old fart. Instead, I find both journalism and politics, the two fields I have cared about most, in a parlous state, and rather than coasting out on a long, merry burst of laughter, I am buckling up for what looks like a last hideous stand against Mordor. Natch, I'm sure, will win. But we need a trumpet call in here. For attention, for help, for battle. Now is the time for all good men and women to come to the aid of their country. Attention must be paid, work must be done. I may be an optimist, but I'm also as frightened as I have been for this country since the Saturday night massacre under Richard Nixon, when I really thought he might call out the troops. In a different way, almost with our permission, I think we're that close to losing all of it. The Constitution, freedom, rule of law, even the dream of economic and social justice. Did you know that in 19th century America, politics was the entertainment that more than filled in for both television and movies? It was the equivalent of all the college and professional sports teams added together. People listened to politicians giving long speeches as though their lives depended on it. It was considered better than the zoo, better than the circus, better than the Friday night lights. And it wasn't about who won or lost, it was about how your life would turn out. People understood that, and they knew their decisions mattered. Where did it go, that understanding? When did politics become about those people in Washington, or those people in Austin, instead of about us? We own it. We run it. It's our country, not theirs. They're just the people we hired to drive the bus for a while. I hear people say, oh, I'm just not interested in politics. Well, they're all crooks anyway. Or, there's nothing I can do. Because I have been writing about politics for 40 years, I know where that cynicism comes from, and I would not presume to tell you it is misplaced. The system is so screwed up, if you think it's not worth participating in, then give yourself credit for being alert, but not for being smart. How smart is it to throw away power? How smart is it to throw away the most magnificent political legacy any people has ever received? This is our birthright. We are the heirs. We get it just for being born here. It says in the Declaration, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men and women are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, that to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed, that whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or to abolish it. More than 200 years later, people all over the world are willing to die for a chance to live by those ideals. They died in South Africa. They died at Tiananmen Square. They're dying today in Myanmar. Don't throw that legacy away out of cynicism or boredom or inanition. I'm just not interested in politics. There's nothing I can do. You have more political power than 99% of all the people who have ever lived on this planet. You can not only vote, you can register other people to vote. Round up your friends, get out and do political education. talk to people, laugh with people, call the radio, write the paper, write your elected representative, use your email list, put up signs, march, volunteer, and raise hell. All your life, no matter what else you do, butcher, baker, beggarman, thief, doctor, lawyer, Indian chief, you have another job, another responsibility. You are a citizen. It is an obligation that requires attention and effort. And on top of that, you should make it a hell of a lot of fun. Having fun while fighting for freedom is, as you will see from this book, one of my life causes. I see no reason why we should not laugh, and in fact, I think we should insist on it. So if this is all so glorious and funny, what went wrong? We won the Cold War after 50 years, and suddenly our politics is all sour, angry, ugly, full of people who can't discuss public affairs without getting all red in the face, until the tendons stand out and their necks and their wattles shake like a turkey gobbler's. Good grief. Plenty of blame to go around for this revolting development, but I do want to point out those who deliberately use ugly language for political advantage. One is Rush Limbaugh, a silly man. Another is Newt Gingrich, so deeply hypocritical I wonder how he functions. But I think far more damaging is the planned, corporately funded, interlocking web of propaganda. The think tanks underwritten by corporate funders, the academic journals underwritten by corporate funders, the right-wing newspapers, radio, and television, not to mention low-life, bottom-feeding garbage collectors funded by right-wing extremists. Hillary Clinton once called this a vast right-wing conspiracy, but it is not. It is all right there out in the open. It has been growing before our eyes for more than 30 years for anyone to see. Growing up in East Texas, I knew many racists and batshit John Birchers, as well as a few splendid Goldwater libertarians. For a long time, conservative was just another word for racist in Texas. I first ran across another form of conservatism in the Rocky Mountains in the late 1970s as the Sagebrush Rebellion or Wise Use Movement, corporate-funded anti-environmentalism. From the beginning, it was all about right-wing money. Coors, Mellon Scaife, same old batty anti-New Deal money that was always behind the Republican right. They were against taxes on rich people and against taxes on business. Didn't want limits on pollution, didn't want limits on exploiting natural resources. Greed is good, the market is God. Same old sorry claptrap we have heard since the era of the robber barons. Unleash capitalism and everything will be dandy. As though Ayn Rand and Milton Friedman were actually saying anything new. Sheesh! Having been born and raised amongst foot-washing Baptists, I've never considered them strange or other. They are my friends, my neighbors, and my kinfolk. Good people. You don't mess with them, they don't mess with you. I suspect that changed for three reasons. First, Roe versus Wade. Second, sophisticates who created resentment by dissing and dismissing believers. And third, political opportunism. Abortion is an issue over which neither side is able to agree to disagree. The obvious and perhaps flip answer is that if you believe abortion is murder, you shouldn't have one. If you believe that every fertilized human egg is in fact the precise equivalent of a full human being, no one, including the government, can force you to have an abortion. People, especially men, tend to be uncomfortable with discussions of female plumbing, so I apologize for bringing up what an old friend called dank, womb-like subjects. Still, approximately one-fourth of all fertilized eggs are swept out on the menstrual tide before they even get near to implanting themselves in the uterine wall, and we do not hold funerals over Kotex or Tampax. I suggest to you this means that the beginning of life is not a single specific event, but rather a process that deserves increasing respect as it continues toward birth. Precisely the tripartite system set up under Roe v. Wade. And if you hear Roe v. Wade described as abortion on demand, you are listening to a liar. I respect those who oppose abortion, but I do not think they have a right to use the law as an instrument of coercion against people who do not believe, and it is a matter of faith, as they do. They have no right to make this decision for someone else, nor does the government. Some women do not have the physical, psychological, or economic resources to bear a child. There were an estimated 1 million abortions a year in this country before Roe. Abortion can be safe and legal, or dirty and illegal. It cannot be stopped. Though I think the anti-choice crowd has every right to make their arguments, I think they are being used. Ditto the people who think gay is an abomination. I do not think the Christian right is driving what is happening in this country politically, nor is it even an equal partner with economic conservatism. I think it is being used as a tool by people with another agenda entirely. Republican political operatives who are interested in lower corporate taxes are using the Christian right for their own purposes. I think there's a very large extent to which the Christian right is being played for a bunch of suckers by country club conservatives.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.